Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Override. Discover your brain type, why you do what you do, and how to do it better. By Connell Cowan, PhD, and David Kipper, MD. Narrated by Mike Chamberlain. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to charts and images present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. Comfort. Too much of a good thing. Why do I keep doing things I know don't serve my best interests? Answer. An unconscious addiction to comfort. Why do I do things I know take away from the quality of my life? And why don't I do the things that would be helpful and constructive for me? These are the questions most of us have some ongoing struggle with. Why do I sabotage myself and let my diet fall apart? Why, when I plan to go to the gym, do I find myself heading for home instead? Why do I blow up at my kids when I know a more measured approach would be more effective? Why do I find myself holding back when I'd like to be less cautious? Why, when I can only afford to pay the minimum on my credit card, do I find myself online ordering still another something I really don't need? Why, when I need to be studying, do I find myself lost again scrolling through social media? Why do I worry about my health when nobody else seems to be so focused on theirs? Why is taking the edge off with that drink or two when I get home from work so compelling? Why do I worry so much? Why do I tend to see the bright side when my husband, looking at the same facts in our life, comes up with more pessimistic views? Why do I have to find myself avoiding things I'd like to be able to do, indulging in things I shouldn't? Why? A new theory we've been validating for years provides some clear and practical answers to these questions. In its most stripped-down form, the theory posits that human beings, over the millennia, have developed two different coping styles, rooted in their genetics, based upon their brain chemistry, and activated by stress. These styles provide some valuable attributes to us, as well as some predictable challenges. As a species, we are uniquely primed to possess foresight and an ability to project into the future in highly complex ways. We use this capacity of ours to guide our decisions. Picture this. In each of our minds, we have a stage upon which we run through a variety of scenarios. Studies show that around the age of 4 or 5, we begin to understand an important aspect of reality, that events can play out in very different ways, and we interact with and actively shape these outcomes. In essence, we are fortune tellers, contingency generators. If we do this or that, then this or that might happen. These scenarios, designed to model possible outcomes, provide the basic calculus for our actions. On these stages in our minds, we apply different filters to the scenarios we envision, each generating information, the accumulation of which shapes our behavior. These filters are comprised of the memories of past experiences, the connection to the culture we live in, family influences and traditions, values and attitudes, feelings for others around us, the ability to imagine, our needs and desires, the physical constraints of the situation, and the deeply hidden influence of our unique brain chemistry. It is that last filter influencing our behavior that is the one we've struggled to understand for many years and is the core of our theory and subject of this book. How we got together. We first met decades ago through mutual friends, and almost immediately dived into discussing the overlaps in our respective fields. As a physician, David had his hands more than full dealing with the what's of the ailing human body, while Connell, as a psychiatrist, sorted out the why and how of things. David knew, of course, that many of his patients' symptoms were psychological in origin, and Connell saw patients who, irrespective of their personal issues, experienced the effects of their distress in all too real physical terms. Sometimes we argued, and other times agreed, but always we learned from each other. And we both knew that the what and the why of illness were intimately connected. What we both agreed upon was that the joker in the deck was stress. Good stress, bad stress, it didn't matter. This wild card would surface and upset the apple cart. One of our first go-rounds centered on whether peptic ulcers were caused primarily by stress. David said, "You're going to give me an ulcer with your undocumented stress theory." He, of course, had the last laugh when, in 1982, a bacterium called H. pylori was found to be a major cause of ulcers. Our writing interests took us in different directions for some time. David explored the dynamics of addiction and brain chemistry, while Connell published books on relationship issues. But always our talks returned to the complex intersection of stress and illness. We have now shared 40 years of dialogue and collaboration. Our friendship has deepened. We've seen each other through times that were trying and painful, and those that were celebratory, shared birthdays, the deaths of our parents, and Dodger games on hot summer nights, not to mention a few beers along the way. We also share several traits. Our interest in our work intersects with our interests in life. We both have an insatiable curiosity about why things are the way they are, and we care deeply about our friends and families and those we've treated. That's about where our similarities end. David is much more gregarious and outgoing, while Connell is more reticent and contemplative. If David looks on the bright side, Connell peers into the shadows. Up sprang a sort of Jack Sprat partnership between the two of us, in which we each serve an essential function. Over the years, we've witnessed the country experience an exponential rise in competition, productivity, and stress. And increasingly, we saw how the emotional issues of our patients complicated their physical complaints, and vice versa. By sharing patients, we undertook a deep exploration of the links between these two spheres, the emotional and the physical. It became increasingly clear that stress, and how our patients handled it, was the biggest single factor in determining both overall contentment or good mental health and length of life. Some patients developed strategies to recognize and deal with stress, while others were resistant to this fix, not recognizing the enormity of the issue. We traced the impact of stress on our own lives as well. We learned that stress was actually not our problem. Instead, it's our reaction to the discomfort created by the stressors, good and bad, that was the key. This was a celebrated missing piece of our puzzle. As we and our patients aged, we became fascinated by the exciting and emerging science of biogerontology. More specifically, we turned our attention to the core causes of aging and the ways in which our lifestyles and attitudes either speed up or slow down that process. Everyday stress and pressure affect everything from our organs, our microbiome, and our risk for illness, to our sleep patterns, our willingness to exercise, our eating habits, and our emotional state. Stress and longevity were clearly commingled factors. We set out to try to understand how they related to each other. We constructed an elaborate way to measure aging speed. In essence, we developed an in-depth questionnaire from which we would calculate what we referred to as a longevity quotient, or LQ, with LQ inversely correlated to aging speed. The higher the LQ, the slower the aging speed. The questionnaire was scaled in a way similar to an intelligence test, with the average LQ set at 100. We called this instrument the longevity scan. Unfortunately, the test had built-in shortcomings. It was comprised of nearly 400 items that required information patients had to get from their doctors, making it a cumbersome exercise. Still, it gave us valuable data on how patients compared to others of their age and gender. But what it didn't do was explain, beyond having good or bad genes, why some people had higher scores than others, or how best to help people with low scores raise them in a sustainable way. We had plenty of clear and useful information to share with patients. Understanding the healthful changes they could make in their lives was never the obstacle. The stubborn hurdle was their resistance to using the information and actually making the changes. We plowed through a mountain of studies on stress and its damaging effects on our bodies and sense of well-being. But in truth, we were stuck. Even though we'd left the door of possibilities ajar, there were no deeper discoveries in sight. What we had was unwieldy, with too many permutations and combinations, and we continued to scratch our heads, unable to gain insight into the durability of someone's inability to make and sustain healthy changes. Then, bingo! We had an epiphany. It had been right under our noses all along. What we had been looking for were predictable clusters of behavior that correlated with age-related illness and accelerated or slowed aging damage. What we found was much deeper. The clusters of behavior we saw weren't related directly to aging, but rather to arousal. Or, more precisely, the level of excitation in the central nervous system. People who were understimulated behaved in predictable ways that were very different from those who felt overstimulated. Our behavior is related to the distribution of our neurotransmitters, and these behaviors are expressions of stress coping. The patterned strategies people use to manage stress are hardwired, embedded in our inherited neurochemistry. Getting our noses out of studies and papers, we suddenly recognized these patterns in our family, friends, patients, and yes, ourselves. So simple and elegant. When stressed, we will behave in a certain way, and the roots of that behavior are coded in the building blocks of the autonomic nervous system. Our autonomic nervous system, which should be called the automatic nervous system, is the branch of our physiology that controls those life-sustaining systems that we unconsciously take for granted. The beating of our heart, how we breathe, how our blood pressure adapts to changing positions, how our brain cleanses itself and deletes or stores the day's memories when we sleep, and the reflexive behaviors that appear when we are stressed. Why did some of our patients struggle with symptoms connected to how they calm themselves, smoking that cigarette, eating that chocolate cake, having another glass of wine, while others had issues that stemmed from a need to increase nervous system stimulation in order to self-soothe, making that unnecessary extravagant purchase, blowing up at their colleague, spending hours playing action-packed video games? The answer astounded us. All of them, some more neatly than others, fell generally along one side or the other from a need to either calm or stimulate themselves to get comfortable. The wiring of our autonomic nervous system is inherited. We get the distribution of our various brain chemicals from good old mom and dad. Then we structure our lives, our personalities, our habits, in reaction to the coursing of those chemicals. For much of the time, these patterned tendencies remain in the background, largely unnoticed. They come to the foreground and exert their influence during stressful events or calls for decision-making. This nascent understanding became the lodestar for a novel theory of stress management that we have documented and confirmed over the years with scientific data. Using sets of slightly unbalanced neurotransmitters, Mother Nature has given us two very different stress coping styles. Could this be some sort of accident? We think not. We believe that these different styles conferred important survival advantages depending upon the presenting circumstances of the stressor. Had one style proved more successful across the centuries, natural selection would have given us one style instead of two, possessing very different strengths and weaknesses. We found something else that was particularly striking. We humans aren't the only creatures who deploy these divergent stress coping strategies. These offensive, defensive, bold, cautious responses are expressed across the animal kingdom. Let's explore a couple of examples. Two monkeys, placed in side-by-side, see-through cages, were given slices of cucumber as treats along with their usual fare. Both monkeys were quite content receiving the cucumber treats, until one monkey got the regular slice of cucumber, while the other got a big, plump grape. This is where the story gets interesting. It turns out we are not the only species that has a sense of fairness. In this study of induced stress, it didn't take long for the cucumber monkey to note that his pal next door was being treated very differently, was getting something better. This blatant inequality caused unease in both monkeys, but not enough for the grape-getting monkey to share his treats, with the cucumber monkey experiencing the greater stress. In fact, monkeys receiving the veggie treat got angry and either threw the cucumber slice back at the experimenter or turned away and refused to accept it. Monkey pout. This pattern with different monkey pairs was repeated multiple times with the same behavioral results. Non-grape-getting monkeys dealt with this induced stress by either becoming aggressive or behaving as if they didn't care. Let's call this the sword or shield defense. The aggrieved monkey either whipped out a sword or put up a shield in response to the injustice. The stress induced in these monkeys revealed two distinct coping styles. Another example of how stress coping styles sort out into two types can be seen in the behavior of the great tit. A great tit is a small but fierce bird making its home in woodlands, parks, and gardens from Europe to Asia. It is powerful and formidable for its size, with a bill capable of breaking open hazelnuts, acorns, and even the occasional heads of smaller prey. But as tough as these little birds are, they are no match for their nemesis, the stronger sparrowhawk. Studying stress in this species, researchers exposed 12 great tit populations to the recorded call of the hunting sparrowhawk during the great tit's normal breeding season from early April to late June. Normally, the majority of these birds breed late in the season, but faced with the clear threat of a hunting predator, some undaunted great tit pairs bred earlier than they normally would. Their less courageous brethren did exactly the opposite, choosing to breed very late in the season. There were no differences in the breeding success, regardless of whether they bred earlier or later than normal. Hearing the call of their mortal enemy, the sparrowhawk, resulted in some taking their chances and breeding very early in their season, while others, stressed by the same calls, chose to wait and breed much later in the cycle. Two different coping styles, just like what was observed in the grape-deprived monkeys. Cole Porter was way ahead of the science when he wrote, "Birds do it, bees do it." Assuming his "it" was a reference to how animals manage their stress in two very different behavioral patterns. And yes, we humans do "it" as well. We were thinking about calling our book Monkeys, Great Tits, and You, but thought the title might be misunderstood. So, what about you? Before we go any further, we'd like you to take a short test. Follow the simple instructions, score your answers as directed, and don't overthink your responses. This test predicts which of these great tribes you are likely to align with, particularly when responding to stressful situations. Are you more likely to counter adversity with aggression? Or is your nature to be more cautious? Are you a monkey pouter? Or a great tit with premature procreation? Let's find out. Please choose either true or false for each statement. Personal Brain Type Questionnaire. 1. I worry more than other people I know. 2. I sometimes act before taking the time to consider all the issues. 3. I enjoy a good adrenaline rush. 4. I look at all the angles before taking action. 5. By nature, I think of myself as being outwardly expressive. 6. If I want something, I want it right now. 7. I seem to worry a lot about my health. 8. I'm not known for being aggressive. 9. I'm pretty easily distracted. 10. I prefer to lead rather than follow. 11. I often begin new projects before I finish the ones I've started. 12. Social situations can make me nervous. 13. I'm willing to wait, sacrifice, and plan for things I want. 14. I'm always on the hunt for something new. 15. Fairly often, I find myself worrying to excess. 16. It's hard for me to express my anger, and I often hold it in. 17. I hate having to do the same old things over and over. 18. When things go wrong, I tend to blame myself. 19. I'm pretty assertive most of the time. 20. People know when I'm mad. 21. I sometimes find myself saying yes when I really mean no. 22. I look at the big picture instead of paying attention to the small details. 23. I'm not easily thrown by uncertainty. 24. Being flexible is one of my strong suits. 25. It's often difficult for me to focus. 26. When it comes to risk, I'm very cautious. 27. I'm good at paying attention to detail. 28. I tend to keep many of my feelings hidden. 29. I'm at my best early in the morning. 30. I think slowly, but I'm pretty accurate. Scoring. For every answer marked as true, fill in the circle corresponding to the question number on the graphics of the brain located in the print version of this book. Whichever brain has more circles filled represents your brain type, shield or sword. You will likely have circles filled on both images. That's because there are no pure brain types. As you can see, swords tend to have some shield tendencies within them, and vice versa. However, your predominant brain type will predict both how you are likely to respond to stress and the ways in which you will manage discomfort. Congratulations! You have now identified yourself as a sword or shield in terms of how you're likely to react and cope with stress. If you have more circles filled in on the shield brain, you are likely to be less aggressive and carry a shield into your battle with stress. But if you filled in more on the sword brain, then pick up your blade and understand how you wield it. As you may now surmise, one of humanity's tribes, the swords, is coded to be particularly sensitive to stimulation, novelty, and reward, while the shields of the world are coded to be more sensitive to avoiding harm and danger. Each coping style possesses strengths as well as an array of behavioral shortcomings. See how your sword or shield behaviors line up with the following list. And as we've indicated, you may recognize some of your behaviors on both sides of this chart. And this is consistent with our knowledge that we all share some behaviors on our non-dominant brain type side of the equation. Brain type behaviors. Shields. Contemplative in nature. Tends toward introversion. Swords. Expressive in nature. Tends toward extroversion. Shields. Parasympathetic reactivity. Swords. Sympathetic reactivity. Shields. Seeks to avoid stimulation. Swords. Seeks out stimulation. Shields. Easily aroused. Swords. Difficult to arouse. Shields. Motivated by avoiding punishment. Swords. Motivated by anticipating reward. Shields. likely to imprint more memories of negative outcomes. Swords, likely to imprint more memories of positive outcomes. Shields, tends to think before acting. Swords, tends to act before thinking. Shields, able to delay gratification. Swords, finds it difficult to delay gratification. Shields, controls impulses easily. Swords, controls impulses poorly. Shields, low need for novelty. Swords, seeks out novelty. Shields, tends to be risk-averse. Swords, tends to be risk-tolerant. Shields, holds anger in. Swords, lets anger out. Shields, tends toward pessimism. Swords, tends toward optimism. Shields, thinking style is slow but accurate. Swords, thinking style is fast but often inaccurate. Shields, high attention to detail. Swords, low attention to detail. Shields, avoids routines. Swords, depends on routines. Shields, flexible and adaptive to change. Swords, rigid, doesn't do well with change. Shields, tendency toward hypochondriasis. Swords, tendency toward symptom denial. Shields, sexual problems. Swords, sexual addictions. Shields, addictions likely to alcohol and sedatives. Swords, addictions likely to cocaine and other stimulants. Shields, high pain tolerance. Swords, low pain tolerance. The understanding of these two distinctive patterns that humans deploy to manage stress provides an explanation for a variety of behaviors whose origins have remained poorly understood. More important, it points the way to type-specific interventions that have proved effective when stress coping styles go awry in the lives of our patients. Two kinds of people. This idea of two personality types is not a novel one. Remember type A and B personalities? Popularized by a 1974 bestseller, Type A Behavior and Your Heart, this theory posited that hard-driving, type A patients were significantly more prone to heart attacks than the more easygoing type Bs. The science behind the theory was ultimately discredited. The authors, cardiologists Meyer Friedman and Ray H. Rosenman, had failed to account for other type A habits, such as a penchant for drinking, smoking, and eating rich foods. But since everyone knew someone who fit the description of the type A personality, the boss who screams, the easily angered father, or the workaholic exercise junkie, and since the theory carried so much common sense validity, the term persisted, for it seems to tell us something profound about the way we were racing around, letting stress drive us to an unhealthy, even deadly degree. For his part, Meyer Friedman grew to resist the way people spoke of his theory as one of personality types, which seems to imply you were born being one or the other and couldn't interact very effectively with your own health outcome. He attempted to put the emphasis back onto behavior, and he developed a program through which type A's could reduce their risk of heart attack. Friedman said that, with work, he himself had evolved from a type A into a type B. The science has come a long way since Friedman's type A and B descriptions, but his notion that there are two broad kinds of people was spot on. Deepening the story. Neurotransmitter type imbalances. One challenge we all face from the day of our birth onward is the stress of simply being alive over the passage of time. How we deal with this inevitable force determines lifelong success, fulfilling intimate relationships, and vitality, or their opposites, failure and ineffectiveness at work, unhappy family lives, and poor health. Why do some of us take totally unnecessary chances, while others are more prudent and cautious? Why are some of us so aggressive with our anger, while others seem to suffer silently or blame themselves? Why are some able to defer gratification so easily, while others experience that kind of waiting for the reward as excruciating? Why are some of us rigid and others more adaptable and flexible? Why is establishing healthy routines easy for some and much more difficult for others? Why are some of us prone to anxiety, while others seem so undaunted by life? Why? We don't will these things, we notice them. These underlying tendencies are the manifestation of our neurochemistry. They are translated into our everyday behavior and approach to life, written in the blueprint of our DNA. Where in our body we are sorted into one of these two teams may surprise you. No, it's not in our brains, as you may have guessed. The story starts deep in our gut, in a strange little neighborhood located in the small intestine. It is the code written within a humble batch of cells there that governs the distribution of chemicals, neurotransmitters, that stream throughout our nervous system and profoundly influence our behavior. The orchestration of these neurotransmitters plays out through the instruments of our autonomic nervous system and creates our very personalized brain type. The autonomic nervous system operates with two powerful branches. The first component is the sympathetic system, designed to excite, arouse, and motivate us. The second, the parasympathetic system, is oppositely programmed to relax, inhibit, and calm us. As a species, we wouldn't have survived without these two competing arms of our nervous system. The neurotransmitters that fire these two systems are in a constant and dynamic drive for homeostasis or balance, to restore comfort, the perception of safety. If the sympathetic system is activated, the parasympathetic system responds to calm things down and reestablish balance. The sensory signal we recognize for stabilization in the brain is comfort. Whether or not it's in our best interest to feel comfortable at that exact moment or with that particular decision. Unfortunately, none of us possesses the perfect balance of arousing and calming neurotransmitters due to a variety of genetic, epigenetic, the circuits that tell a gene to turn on or to remain silent, and environmental influences. The distribution of our neurotransmitters tends to be more imbalanced in one of two directions. We believe these subtle imbalances to be a byproduct of evolutionary forces and to have conferred upon us modern humans an important tool for survival. This translates into a nervous system that is driven by neurotransmitter imbalances, primarily deficiencies of these brain chemicals, that are either on the excitatory, stimulating side, or inhibitory, calming side. One or the other of these imbalances predominates, has the controls, and is singularly focused on an effort to maintain the perception of comfort. These two neurochemical imbalances are shaped by either dopamine, boss of the excitatory system, or serotonin, the inhibitory system chief. Dopamine, with its team members adrenaline, noradrenaline, glutamate, and acetylcholine, all act to excite the nervous system and are at the heart of the fight-or-flight response to a perceived threat. It's no accident that this most basic response to stress mirrors these two brain-type tendencies. The neurotransmitter dopamine also controls our motivation, pleasure, and reward circuitry. Every love letter ever written is drenched in dopamine, as is every blackjack chip laid down on the table, every ambition, every adventure embarked upon. The serotonin system, with its neurotransmitter cousin GABA, acts to calm an overamped brain and is in the driver's seat in the areas of anxiety, mood, and obsessions, or their more pleasant opposites, openness and a sense of well-being. Every caution felt, impulse controlled, gratification deferred, every action withheld or avoided is related to the influence of serotonin. Our big brains translate these neurotransmitter-driven styles into both conscious and unconscious behavior. This is where our shield and sword style comes into play. The decisions and behavioral leanings influenced by brain chemical imbalances are put in place and maintained by how much cortical activation or arousal there is in the system. Swords usually function with a bit too little arousal, and shields with a bit too much. These relatively stable and consistent imbalances in arousal are the drivers of different patterns and tendencies. But there are exceptions. Can we identify primarily as a shield or a sword, but also see aspects of our decisions and actions that are more associated with the other side? The short answer is absolutely. We all do at certain times or under certain circumstances. Cortical arousal has not only typical set points or levels within individuals, but also fluctuations. Context and situation are powerful determinants in shaping these changes in arousal levels. For example, shields are not always cautious and protective. They can be much bolder and more expressive when they feel safe. Signals of safety have the effect of reducing, only temporarily, arousal and releasing less cautious decisions. Make any shield feel really safe, and you'll see them flash their hidden blades. Any heightened emotionality causes a rise in cortical arousal. Swords don't like too much arousal in the system any more than do shields. Anger fits that mold. Anger is pent-up arousal, and swords are more likely to seek a release, reduction, through blame and externalizing anger. Having the same surfeit of arousal, shields are more likely to reduce the discomfort by directing that negative energy inward. So, feeling safe is a releaser of sword tendencies in shields, and feeling unsafe is a releaser of shield-like behaviors in swords. Why? Again, it's all about arousal. Take, for example, a health scare, where a person is waiting to get the results of a potentially devastating diagnosis. During these times, swords can exhibit distinctly shield-like behaviors. Anxiety, obsessive-compulsive disorder, OCD, and depression are more on the shield side, but not necessarily when a sword's level of arousal is elevated by feeling threatened. Because they are deficient in the calming brain chemical serotonin, shields rarely feel too little arousal. But due to circumstances and situational events, swords can and do experience too much arousal. Threats, be they emotional or physical, cause jolts of arousing brain chemicals, leaving swords feeling hurt, anxious, and unsafe. During these moments of heightened arousal, swords, too, look for ways to reduce it. If the threat is emotional, they seek external ways to release the arousal, chiefly by the expression of anger. But if the threat is physical, as in our example of possibly getting a bad diagnosis, swords can exhibit the same internal compensatory behaviors as do shields, anxious spinning and catastrophizing. Bottom line, too much or too little arousal is odious and uncomfortable for both shields and swords. Clearly, there is a Goldilocks effect to cortical arousal. Not too little and not too much, but just the right amount, is what we all like. Understanding stress and its relationship with comfort. Stress, of course, is unavoidable. No one lives a life without having to deal with it. What exactly is stress? Most simply put, it is any disturbance to our internal sense of balance. As a species, we were built to handle distressful threats, and plenty of them. But our first-line armor against this assault was designed to deal with short-term events where the disturbance to balance was resolved quickly. Out of the corners of our eyes, we see a car bearing down on us, and we step out of the way. Without waiting for us to fully process the event, our amygdala sends a message to the hypothalamus, the command center in our brain, causing a cascade of chemical releases and activating the sympathetic nervous system. This component of our autonomic nervous system then broadcasts signals to the adrenal glands that begin pumping adrenaline into the bloodstream. You know that feeling. Sweaty palms, rapidly beating heart. Airways in our lungs open to provide more oxygen. Our senses sharpen, and blood sugar and stored fats flood the vascular system to provide immediate energy. Next, the hypothalamus triggers the other component of the stress response system, the HPA axis, the hypothalamus, the pituitary, and adrenal glands. This network is designed to keep the sympathetic nervous system fired up. Then, if our brain still registers a threat, the stress hormone cortisol is released, keeping the body on high alert status. However, once we know we're safe, we pause for a moment on the sidewalk, breathing a sigh of relief as the braking part of the nervous system kicks in to calm the chemical storm in our body, sending out an all-clear signal. The event has ended. We all handle that kind of distressful event pretty easily, and it doesn't cause any long-term damage to our bodies. Chronic, low-lying stress is a whole other matter. Perhaps the most relatable example of the subtle drip, drip, drip of stress is what we've all gone through during the pandemic, causing increases in domestic violence, alcohol intake, and mental health events. This kind of stress can be so subtle and omnipresent that we adapt to the signals of its presence. But our bodies don't. Stress is not only uncomfortable emotionally, it also is, in its increasingly prevalent chronic form, harmful to the body. If soon-to-be mothers are stressed, their babies are dosed with their stress as they slide along the birth canal and get smeared with mom's microbiome. This early exposure to stress hormones can cause permanent negative changes to the immune system, and this may explain why there is so much variance in how well people ward off infections and even some chronic diseases. Stress even possesses the capacity to remodel the brain. Studies show that the stress hormone norepinephrine, activated during a stressful event, creates long-lasting structural effects upon our neurons and other brain cells. These physical changes alter brain function and can lead to anxiety, depression, and drug addiction. Stress and how we cope with its sinister impact on our health plays a pivotal role in all the age-related illnesses: cancer, diabetes, heart disease, and dementia. It shortens telomeres and shortens lives. Despite the remarkable advances in medical technology, life expectancy in the United States is going down. This sad downward trajectory is largely attributable to but one factor: our inability to deal with stress in healthy ways. The increases in liver disease, drug overdoses, and suicides are primarily stress-related outcomes. And, as if simply living in our competitive, sped-up world wasn't stressful enough, the trauma of the coronavirus pandemic landed, causing even greater distress to an already divided country. How we've learned to cope with stress. Without much thought, we all do battle with the myriad stressors in our lives. Instinctively, we know stress is dangerous for us. We know this because stress feels uncomfortable. Stress creates an emotional disequilibrium, and our natural tendency is to try to return to a state of balance and homeostasis. Whether we're swords or shields, we use our internal balance comfort barometer to ward off these unpleasant experiences. As humans, we've been doing this since we spread across the globe. And the truth is that the strategies we use have been successful if maintaining some relative state of comfort is the criterion. The problem is that while comfort is a powerful motivational spur, it doesn't always lead us in healthy directions. In many ways, our instinctive, comfort-driven coping strategies have led us astray. Often, the smarter coping strategy would be to override the siren of comfort and toughen up a bit. But we've all gotten soft, and our indulgence in comfort is hurting us. It's not smart to trade short-term comfort for long-term hurt. As described, chronic stress carries along with it HPA activation and a production of the hormone cortisol. A nervous system redolent with cortisol is a system on high alert. Sword and shield brains deal with the presence of this hormone in different ways. Shields, deficient in the calming brain chemical serotonin, are left in a state of heightened vigilance that reads as potential threat and anxiety. The net effect of this low-lying stress is to accentuate shields' innate tendency to go into protection mode and avoid any circumstances or activities associated with signals of potential distress. Sword brains process the drip of cortisol as aggravation or irritation. Their response to this uncomfortable situation is to look for some way to discharge the tension, usually some expression of anger. And remember, swords are deficient in the brain chemical dopamine that fires the reward center of the brain. Instead of being harm-sensitive like shields are, swords are reward-sensitive. The presence of cortisol has a muting effect on natural feelings of ease and pleasure, leaving swords hungry for some sort of dopamine hit, and making it more difficult for them to delay gratification, and making impulse control more difficult. What's important to understand here is your relationship with arousal. There is no easy measure of arousal, no thermometer or blood pressure cuff, no lab test. We each sense our level of arousal in subjective ways. For swords, where arousal is typically on the low side, the experience of that sensation is often described as feeling bored, distractible, edgy, or irritable. And for shields, the sensation of feeling overly aroused is most often described as subtle distress, nervousness, and anxiety. Were we able to have some magical rheostat to dial arousal up or down, we would feel more comfortable and not have to employ strategies to raise or lower our levels. It comes down to this. We unconsciously look for a way either to tamp down stimulation or to ramp it up. Swords and shields have different thresholds for getting comfortable. Shields tend to feel overstimulated pretty easily. Because of those feelings, they unconsciously regulate their discomfort by engaging in behaviors that reduce arousal, trying to get back to a feeling of comfort or normality. Swords, deficient in dopamine, tend to feel understimulated and unconsciously correct by looking for ways to create sensation and increase arousal. Stress is demanding. It packs the power of a 2-year-old squalling on the department store floor after you pried loose the toy grabbed along the way. Everyone's eyes are on you. You have to do something. That's where habit kicks in. Habit is what we know, the comfort of the familiar, what's worked for us in the past. And these habitual reactions are governed by our brain chemical imbalances. We are all creatures of habit, and our habits can have as much good judgment and intelligence as the moon has cheese. How many of us walk in the door after work, pour ourselves a martini, put our feet up on the coffee table, and watch the evening news? What happened to that bag of chips? I couldn't have eaten the whole thing. Or we may find ourselves screaming at the kids or losing our temper with our spouse over some perceived transgression. Or maybe we close our eyes for a few minutes, attempting to meditate, until our cell phone chirps out a notification demanding our attention. So much for meditation. And then there's the temptation of prying open a pint of peppermint chocolate chip ice cream, telling ourselves we deserve it after a day like we had today. All of these behaviors are designed to regain an acceptable level of arousal, which becomes synonymous with being comfortable. Habit is blind and all about immediacy. As the stressor is processed, a demand for normalcy is experienced, setting in motion the deployment of our unique bag of habitual tricks, Relief is just a reflexive habit away. Agency is important to the design of an organized life. We all strive to control our experiences and pretend as though we are behind the wheel. But instead of really being in charge, much of the time we act blindly and out of habit. Sure, stress is distinctly unpleasant. Life is filled with annoyances and the anticipation of pressure and discomfort. But until you learn how you've been set up to respond to stress by your brain chemistry, stress will continue to grab you by the back of the neck and push you around. Our mission here is to drill down into how our two tribes are set up to cope with stress and show you how these dynamics operate both for and against you. But this book goes beyond the observational and into the potential. We believe that there are healthier and more constructive ways to cope with the stress, and we are going to show you how to learn to incorporate them into your lives. By understanding your personal reflexive tendencies, you will be able to leverage motivation and make difficult but healthy changes easier and more lasting. Chapter 1. The Irresistible Push and Pull of Arousal. How brain activation, or arousal, unconsciously shapes whether we are focused more internally or externally. Richard Dreyfuss was interviewed on CNN in 2014 after winning the Academy Award and was asked if he planned to write an autobiography. His response gives us a distinct peek into his brain chemistry. "I don't know, but if I do, it will be called The Hunt, because I'm much more comfortable on the hunt." He flashed his brain type in 1982 when he was arrested for cocaine possession after crashing his Mercedes into a palm tree along a winding canyon road in Los Angeles. See if you can find the clues and identify our beloved actor as Sword or Shield. If your analysis revealed a thrill for the hunt to be more meaningful than the prize, his Academy Award, and the risk-taking of driving recklessly, you've only one clue to go. That would be the cocaine. What all these clues have in common is their association with an imbalanced dopamine system. We can be pretty confident that Richard Dreyfuss is a sword. A Shield's autobiography might be titled Overcoming Stage Fright. A Shield might be arrested after crashing his Mercedes, but more likely with alcohol on his breath. While the choices Shields make can be starkly different from those of Swords, their central motivational engine is the same. They are trying to modulate their level of emotional discomfort. But there is a difference in the way that these two tribes experience that discomfort, and it all spins around how they tolerate and process cortical activation or arousal. Yes, it's all about arousal. As we've described, arousal is the amount of stimulation or excitation in the nervous system, and it is the propellant of motivation and the reason we do all of the things we do. Swords are drawn to it, and shields will go out of their way to avoid it. How do you relate to arousal? Any thoughts as to how it pushes you around in small ways in your life? Do you see things you do that are in service of reducing arousal or increasing it? These are a few of the questions to keep in mind as you listen. There are another couple of differences between these brain types we should get right out in the open. Because of their relationship to arousal, swords tend to have a whole lot more fun, while the shields tend to be more comfortable covering their backsides. A recent story covered by CNN illustrates this point. On a freeway leaving Ogden, Utah, an SUV was spotted weaving between the lanes, and police pulled it over. The officer walked up to the driver's side of the car, peered in incredulously, and asked, "How old are you?" 5, the young boy behind the wheel told him. He then spilled out the rest of the story. He'd asked his mother to buy him a Lamborghini and gotten angry when she said no. He collected the $3 he'd saved, along with the keys to the family car, and set off to California to make his dream come true. Let's be really clear here. This little boy is not a shield. A shield example would be decidedly less dramatic, but certainly no less intricate. Had that audacious little boy been a shield instead of a sword, the story might have gone more like the following. A boy dreams of having an exotic sports car. That's probably where the story would stop, because a shield would likely play the ask mom out, imagine her no, and the dream would be internalized. That boy would likely feel the same sting of anger, but it would go unexpressed, and instead of finding the car keys, driving off, and getting pulled over by the police, that child would likely run a series of thought scenarios. One scenario might be something like, what if I get lost and can't find the highway? Another version might be finding the highway and getting far enough away from home only to get stopped by the police. Yet another imagined action might be making it all the way to California successfully and trading those dollars for the car. But all these versions would be played out in his head, all the while he is sitting in his room. Have you ever thought about how controlling you are in your life? How you're most comfortable when you are doing things the way you like to do them? It is that same controlling impulse that pulls the levers in our brain type. Shields do much of their work under the hood, in their minds, while swords wield their controlling needs more through action in the real world. Take a moment and think back. Which kid were you a little more like? Not that you ever borrowed the family car when you were 5, but did you do adventurous things that surprise you looking back on them now? Or were you more restrained and cautious? Nature has given us an amazing gift of these slightly imbalanced teams of brain chemicals. Had we all been born without these imbalances, all of our ways of dealing with the challenges and pressures of living would be similar. Nature appears to favor diversity and somewhat of a heightened response to stress over a more nuanced one. To expand our degrees of freedom, nature selected 2 sets of responses that are mirror images of each other, each hardwired and reflexive. Life over the millennia threw a complex mix of existential threats at our ancestors. Had we not had such oppositional decision-making approaches, and had these coping styles not been built in or had required a lot of calorie-crunching thought, modern human beings may not have survived. Infant swords and shields. Trust and sensory stimulation. Sword and shield traits are evident very early in a child's life and dictate their development. Let us remind you of sword's relationship to arousal. Being short on the cortical activation side leaves swords ever on the lookout for ways to increase it. We all look to feel some subjective version of good, and for swords, that feeling is achieved by engaging a rich stimulus environment. As infants, not only are they tolerant of sensory excitement, they are also comforted by these external inputs. Stimulation is welcome because it raises the level of arousal they are naturally in short supply of. Trust is more easily established in sword babies because of their comfort with stimulation. When you are looking for arousal, the world seems to be a pretty friendly and safe place. Establishing trust always requires a leap of faith, opening up some gap, however small. If you don't open up a gap, no trust is established. If you do, and that gap is filled in a positive way, you've laid down one increment of trust. Drawn to stimulation, social and otherwise, sword children are gap creators, more open to new experiences, social and otherwise. And that easy willingness translates, more often than not, into trust. Trust in themselves as well as others. sword's attraction to stimulation requires a target, and novelty becomes an easy bullseye, capturing attention. This penchant for novelty cuts in two directions. It widens the aperture in a positive way for early social learning, but the same comfort with novel stimulation can lead to mild or sometimes moderate distractibility. The circuits in our brain that control concentration and attention are the same as those that control impulsivity. Being set up to consume novelty is also a setup for poor attentional control. Our shield brothers and sisters have a very different relationship with arousal. Bottom line is that shields have a distinct distaste for arousal, and that dislike forms the spine of their patterned reactions. Their dislike of arousal is no accident. As we've mentioned, having an imbalance on the calming side of their nervous system, they have too little in the way of serotonin available in the right places at the right moment. From the time shields are infants, their experience in the world is a subtle, or sometimes not so subtle, feeling of being overstimulated. And feeling overstimulated is experienced as vaguely dangerous. Given the rude awakening of suddenly having to exit the birth canal, a baby's first emotional hurdle is trust. Still lacking the capacity to regulate their own emotions and inner world, shields are particularly vulnerable to the ways in which they are related to by their mothers. Much has been written about a child's early emotional experiences, from Harry Harlow and his monkeys to Jean Piaget and John Bowlby's seminal work on attachment. While this important literature is beyond the purview of this book, suffice it to say, shield babies are especially in need of a calm, attentive, and nurturing mother. Born without the sufficient brain chemicals to wind themselves down naturally, they need caretakers to demonstrate on a real-time basis that the world and their place in the family are safe. These demonstrations of safety can go a long way toward creating the earliest building blocks of trust. The reason we say demonstrate is because trust can't simply be intended. It is earned and learned over time by consistent, trustworthy, and safe behavior. But despite having a really good mom or dad, shield babies are left with a bit too much arousal for them to feel totally at peace in their own skin for very long. So, to you parents out there, don't despair. You can give your shield baby love, but you can't give them serotonin. Their inherited deficiency in this important brain chemical is no one's fault. In fact, it is nature's way to give your shield baby a very potent way to relate to the world. The potency of the built-in coping style of shield babies carries some predictable and sometimes painful struggles, but it also confers upon them some wonderful strengths and attributes, as we will describe. Early on, Warren Buffett signed up for a Dale Carnegie course to try to overcome his dread of public speaking. Donald Trump put his name on everything, from buildings to beef. He made a fortune selling his dreams, even as he presided over the debris of high-risk ventures, many of which went belly up. While both of these men have been immensely successful, we'll leave it to your surmise which is the shield and which the sword. Pleasure and pain. Marking the role of pleasure in human motivation has its roots in the ancient world and was first proposed by Epicurus. In more modern times, Freud's pleasure principle was used to describe a kind of infantile quest for immediate gratification in the instinctive seeking of pleasure and avoidance of pain. From our perspective, we see this two-sided dynamic a little differently. Pleasure and pain represent the motivational engine for each of our stress-coping styles. Swords and shields are dominated by, or more sensitive to, different parts of the brain. Shields are most affected by the brain's threat detection circuitry, and swords by its reward circuits. For swords, the default motivational strategy is approach, looking to get some sort of pleasurable experience, reward, while Shield's motivational spur is the avoidance of pain, punishment. In fact, a Shield's most instinctual motivation is harm avoidance. The signal that something may be amiss, or that threat or danger may be lurking out there, is, of course, cortical arousal, broadcast by way of the amygdala. That's why we gave them their name. Shields are built to have a defensive and protective posture. And this most primitive and unconscious way to respond subtly colors everything they do throughout their lives. Let's take a closer look at Shields' defensive posture. One way that Shields seek to protect themselves is through the process of worry. Shields can be notorious worriers. Give them the slightest of reasons, and they are all in. Even though worrying is painful, a recent study illuminates how it is rewarded over time. Instead of worrying being linked to the possibility of a bad outcome as simply observational, researchers found something much more surprising. What they discovered was that for worriers, their worrying behavior actually became causal. Here is how it works. The worrier becomes aware of the possibility of a bad outcome and begins the worrying process. Then, lo and behold, the bad outcome doesn't come to pass, and they experience relief. But they don't stop there. They don't simply think, "Well, I worried needlessly." Worriers actually unconsciously link their worrying to the outcome. In other words, they worried, nothing bad happened, and it was their worrying that did the trick. The worrying prevented the bad outcome. And so, you can see how natural-born worriers get their worrying tendencies rewarded over time. What they are left with is not, "I worry even when I don't have to," but some unconscious version of, "If I worry, I can control my outcomes." It's little wonder that Shields spend so much time in their heads. Their brother and sister swords have a muted response to the potential for threat, and are more animated by the possibility of pleasure and getting some sort of reward. Our connection to pleasure has obvious survival value. It's not an accident that food tastes good to us, or that sexual activity is rewarded with a dramatic and pleasurable finish. But swords, born shy on the arousal side, are inherently drawn to possibilities on the upside of the equation. Instead of being cautious and pain-avoidant, they tend to be pleasure-oriented and assertive, providing them with a more offensive posture in the world. Swords inherit their sunnier, outgoing nature in some interesting ways. As you know, swords are sensitive to arousal and look to increase it by stimulating dopamine. To better understand how this comes about, let's take a brief weed dive and look at the DRD2A1 allele. This genetic variant from mom or dad dampens the expression of the dopamine receptors in the brain reward sites, muting dopamine's ability to activate the reward pathway, dulling feelings of joy, pleasure, and aliveness. In its more exaggerated version, this condition is referred to as reward deficiency syndrome. This genetic variant, among others, explains why swords seek out dopamine to normalize the brain's reward system. While shields will go to great lengths to avoid the sensory effect of arousal, swords expend time and energy cobbling together experiences they've learned that jack up arousal. Approach and avoidance. Approach and avoidance is a phrase frequently used to describe conflicts where movement toward a goal has both positive and negative anticipations, leaving it both desirable and undesirable at the same time. It's like one of those moments when you're having a hard time making up your mind about whether to do something or not. Here's the way it works for swords. Faced with the same list of pros and cons, they are more likely to focus on the pros and say yes. Shields, with the same basic information, will tend to emphasize the cons and say no. These oppositional tendencies that characterize swords and shields' decision-making are approach and avoidance, respectively. Imagine two guys in a singles bar having a beer. A good-looking woman glances in their direction, getting the attention of both. Each of these men feels equally attracted to her. Which do you think will walk over and say hello? And which is more likely to sit on the stool as if his pants are glued to it? That's right. The sword gets up and introduces himself to the woman with a smile, while the shield sits enviously by as the glue sets. Both men ran a series of if-then possibilities through their minds, and each added them up and acted on their assessment of those possibilities in different ways. The dynamics of approach and avoidance, of course, play out in all the dimensions of our lives. These tendencies are emotional regulation tools, self-soothing strategies. Swords tend to approach to excite, and shields tend to avoid to calm themselves, and sometimes not in the best interests of either. Let us be clear. Shields don't always say no. In fact, they are often just as likely to say yes. But their yeses tend to satisfy different motivations than the yeses of swords. As an example of this, let's look at overeating. As you know, obesity in this country is at epidemic proportions. Irrespective of our particular brain type, we are all susceptible to overeating and its damage to our health. A donut is a donut, right? Well, not exactly. Shields and swords are at equal risk for excessive weight gain, and both approach the donut, but have different strategic goals for biting into that delectable sweet. Swords overeat to stimulate and increase arousal, and shields eat to self-soothe and avoid it. In fact, it is these differing arousal-regulating motivations that allow us to create leveraged strategies for sustained weight loss, described later in the book. Because of our relationship with arousal, our brain chemicals can lead us to identical behaviors serving goals in direct opposition to one another. And other times, those same chemicals exert their hidden influence on dissimilar decisions and outcomes. Have you ever thought about how you relate to the dimension of uncertainty or certainty? Do you gather together whatever facts you have and quickly come to a conclusion and decision about the event or issue? Or do you tend to stew and worry about the paucity of information at hand, continue poking around trying to tease out more, and defer your decision until more facts become apparent? If you are a sword, you're more in the first category, and if you are a shield, more in the second. Everyone loves certainty, a sure thing, and no one is particularly drawn to uncertainty. But swords tend to be less bothered by uncertainty than are shields because of their differing relationships with arousal. The neurotransmitter dopamine codes for certainty, while serotonin codes for uncertainty. So, what does that mean? When we feel certain about the circumstances surrounding an action or decision, our dopamine neurons fire at a higher rate. This sensory signal carries along with it a go sign that says yes to the experience. And this experience is circular. We like certainty and saying yes because it feels good. Swords, who tend to be oriented toward external sensory cues, are drawn to actions because they stimulate the dopamine-firing reward cycle. They are rewarded by the feedback they receive from their outgoing natures, gain greater confidence over time and experience, and repeat the cycle. Remember the example of the two guys in the bar? Let's say the sensory information they both receive is identical, and let's say it's neutral. They both find the woman attractive, but aren't receiving any signals from her. Let's also say they both have the same wish for companionship. Both of these men have to make a decision, and both make a mental and emotional risk-reward assessment. Both face an uncertain outcome. Here's the separation. Shields will sacrifice the possibility of a reward to satisfy their greater need for certainty information. The reason he sits there on the stool is that he's waiting for a go signal that's muted by the uncertainty in the situation and the perceived threat, possible rejection, embedded in chance-taking. The sword man is less concerned about any downside consequences and goes over and says hello. This orientation toward the world is the very definition of what is known as approach. Shields, as you know, have a different orientation to the world, and that is avoidance. Now, let's take a closer look at avoidance. Avoidance doesn't happen in a vacuum. It happens in the context of possibilities. There are some possibilities that are categorically bad, drowning, and some that are good, breathing. But there is a much more nuanced group of possibilities in between. Stripped away of its good and bad crusts, the loaf of bread is evaluated by shields in a very different way than it is by swords. Shields tend to see its more harmful possibilities, while swords tend to see that same mixed bag of possibilities as potentially beneficial. That range of possibilities, of course, is the same, only the reaction is different. Could this be, in part, because of the size of the amygdala? Studies show that children born with larger amygdalae are shields, are more prone to having anxiety disorders. Swords, as you know, are not as entangled with their amygdala and are more enthralled to their reward system. In fact, swords' innate infatuation with the workings of their reward circuitry makes them vulnerable to addiction. Addictions are simply repetitive actions that provide the pleasurable hit of a reward. Bad habits are those that lead to cheap rewards that are destructive. The brain is a bit like a thick forest. Habits are made by the paths we follow. That first instance, as we walk along, doesn't leave much of an imprint, create neuronal connections in brain language, but repeated travels down that path carve a distinct groove in the forest floor, lay down neural connections. And pretty soon, that's where we find ourselves walking, despite our knowing that the destination may lead to self-defeating effects. Much more about the formation of bad habits, their addictive nature, and their relationship to faulty self-soothing later. As we've said, swords' approach style, seeking arousal, has its benefits and its liabilities. And shields' aversion to arousal comes with its own strengths and weaknesses. A heightened signal of arousal is like a magnet. It always looks for something to attach itself to, a cause that can be understood and possibly controlled. For shields, controlled is the operative word. As the signal strength of arousal rises, shields feel anxious, and if it rises too quickly and too high, they can have anxiety attacks. Setting aside anxiety attacks for the moment, shields learn to control moderate levels of cortical activity by using their default strategy, avoidance. Shields search for an explanation for the arousal, evoking the question, "What's causing this uncomfortable feeling I'm having?" Their second question is, "How can I avoid this thing?" Some definitions here may be helpful. Fear is seeing a bear stepping through the door and gnashing his teeth at you. Anxiety is having a similar feeling with no bear in sight. It's not just uncomfortable, it's disconcerting. The bear isn't there, but the feeling is. Arousal feels dangerous, even though the circumstance connected to it isn't. Some shields, unfortunately, live with these heightened emotional states much of the time. Shields' primary motivational impulse is to avoid harm. Harm, of course, is loosely defined as most anything the arousal gets attached to. Lucy, a woman in her 30s, recalled an experience from her childhood. After school one day, she saw a small knot of children squealing and making noises of shock and excitement. She pushed in to see what they were all looking at. Glancing down, she saw an injured mouse missing one of its legs. She recoiled in horror and disgust, beginning a lifelong fear of rodents. From that moment on, Lucy avoided any and all situations where rodents could be present, and was afraid to enter her son's kindergarten class because they had a hamster as a class pet. Mice are pretty easy to avoid most of the time. Dealing with other people is not. When the arousal is attached to interacting with others, social anxiety can become a problem. Mason, a loving and thoughtful father, had a hard time understanding why his 5-year-old son got sick to his stomach the morning of his birthday party and barely managed to participate. Shields come into social interactions already feeling overstimulated. Add in a bunch of rambunctious kids acting like kids do, and it's easy to get completely overwhelmed. Avoidance gets attached to as many things as it does because it works. It works because avoidant behavior reduces arousal and makes us a little less uncomfortable, at least for the moment. What's important to understand, however, is that avoidance is not simply about a reaction to an event. It is also about anticipation. Shields anticipate an uptick in arousal, and it is that anticipation of discomfort that triggers the avoidant behavior. As humans, we learn behavior that works. Sadly, works is a relative word. We all want to be comfortable, whether comfort at that moment is healthy and constructive or not. Much of human learning requires repetitive actions that are systematically rewarded. Avoidant behavior is no exception. It is learned over time because it is rewarded by the brain. Each avoided action is rewarded by a little nugget of, at least, temporary relief, the building block of habit. Directed from within or without. Over the years, much has been written about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.